Thanks, Shira. So first, I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation to speak here. It's a great pleasure. And thank you, everybody, for coming. I'm going to talk about recent joint work with Pazit Haim-Kislev from Tel Aviv and with Richard Hind from Notre Dame. And what I would like to try to do in this talk is to explain an observation about symplectic rigidity, but one that is associated with symplectic submanifolds and not with Lagrangian submanifolds. And hence we refer to this phenomenon as symplectic barriers. And of course, this notion, the title of the talk is strongly influenced and motivated by the concept of Lagrangian barriers that were the concept was introduced by Paul Biran in 2001. Okay, so that's the plan for the talk, but before we dive into the details, let me first recall some known facts about symplectic rigidity results for Lagrangian submanifolds. I'm going to start with that. The first, probably the most famous example of symplectic rigidity is the so-called Lagrangian intersection phenomenon. If you think about the history of modern symplectic topology from the very early days, Lagrangian submanifolds, it was kind of clear, it still is quite clear, that Lagrangian submanifolds play a central role in the story. And you can keep in mind, for example, the Arnold's conjectures, Gromov's theory of pseudo-holomorphic curves and all its applications, the theory of generating functions, Fleur homology with all its variations, Foucault category, and so on and so forth. In all these examples, symplectic Lagrangian submanifolds play a very important role. And the reason, or partially the reason, is that Lagrangian submanifolds have more intersection points, kind of in a well-understood manner, than what is predicted by topology. And of course, this is something which is very well known and very classical, but I would like to emphasize that this feature completely disappear when you drop the Lagrangian assumption. Or in other words, the Hamiltonian persistence of intersection is a unique phenomenon for Lagrangian submanifolds among, say, half-dimensional submanifolds. And this was proved first by, oh, yes, here it is. So this was proved first by Polterovich under some assumptions, and then by Laudenbach and Sikorov, and then extended to a more general setting by Burrell. And the step is that non-Lagrangians are flexibles as long as there are no topological obstructions. So by non-Lagrangians, I mean that it is enough to have one point such that the tangent space at this point is not a Lagrangian subspace of the ambient symplectic manifolds. Topological obstructions, again, there are several ways to assume those that they do not exist, but for example, assume that there is a normal, the normal bundle has a nowhere vanishing section. And flexibility means that there is a Hamiltonian vector field which is nowhere tangent to the Lagrangian submanifolds. So, in other words, as soon as the submanifold is non-Lagrangian, then this phenomenon disappear. And this is something that I would like you to keep in mind for the rest of the talk. By the way, I should say that please feel free to stop me with any questions, remark, comments, or yes. Okay, so this is the Lagrangian intersection phenomenon, and there is one more remarkable example of symplectic rigidity associated with Lagrangian submanifolds, which was discovered by Paul Biran around 2001, and he used the terminology Lagrangian barriers to describe this phenomenon. And very roughly speaking, it shows the existence of, under some conditions, irremovable intersections between contractible domains, but you can think about just balls, for example, and Lagrangian submanifolds. This is the phenomenon. And this actually follows from a remarkable theorem proved by the decomposition theorem, which was proved by Biran. And I kind of hope that Biran will excuse me for the level of informality that I'm going to use here. But very roughly speaking, what Biran proved is that symplectic manifold or a Keller manifold, under some assumptions that I'm not going to state precisely, can be decomposed into a certain skeleton which is a CW complex, okay. Usually isotropic, sometimes Lagrangian, and that the complement can be shown to be a certain symplectic disk bundle. So this is a very non-precise statement, but my point is that Biran used, essentially, after proving this theorem, methods similar to the one used in the non-squeezing theorem by Gromov to show that one can bound the size of a ball that can be symplectically embedded into the symplectic disk bundle. And as a corollary, he showed that in some cases, when you try to embed large enough ball, then this ball must intersect this skeleton on the left-hand side. To be slightly more precise, the theorem of Biran is that when you're given a polarized Keller of degree K, and you embed inside a ball with radius large enough, 1/π/k, then the image must intersect the skeleton. But again, I didn't tell you how to define the skeleton associated with the polarized Keller manifold. But instead of being more precise about the details of the theorem, let me just show you the main example, which is relevant for this talk. So now I'm going to focus on one example. And this is just the case of CPN. And the skeleton in this case is going to be, just a second, a copy of the standard RPM. And the statement is, if you take a ball with radius R and you try to symplectically embed the ball inside here, then if the radius of the ball is large enough, R square should be greater than 1/2 in this particular case, then the image must intersect R plugin. So this is the example that I want you to keep in mind of a Lagrangian barrier. So RPN in this case is the Lagrangian barrier. Any questions up to this point? Everything is okay?
Yeah, the constant does it come from some normalization of the symplectic form or where does the half come from?
Yeah, I'm using the standard the standard normalization of CPN and RPN. I mean, if you think, I mean, you can, instead of CPN and RPN, you can think about just the unit ball and a Lagrangian subspace, and it would be just the units, the standard normalization.
So,
but you can see this one half also in the theorem above, right? I mean, there is pi that I probably should have put somewhere, but it is closely related to the degree of the polarization.
I see. Thank you.
Okay, so again, Lagrangian barriers, kind of using now the concept of the Gromov width, which just measures the largest ball that we can put inside the manifold. So Lagrangian barriers are just Lagrangian submanifolds, such that the Gromov width of the complement inside the ambient space is less than the Gromov width of the ambient space. Okay, so this is the concept of Lagrangian barriers. And we've seen this example by Yaron, CPN minus RPN. But I should say that there are several other examples. So Biran and Cornea, using actually slightly different methods, they proved that the Clifford torus is a Lagrangian barrier. Recently, there are two different works, one by Brendel and Schlenk, where in this work they proved that certain Lagrangian, well, with some singularities, but certain Lagrangian submanifolds known as Markov pinwheels are also Lagrangian barriers. And there is another work by Lee, O, and Vienna, and they proved that some Lagrangian tori associated with Markov triples are yet also examples of this phenomenon, the phenomenon of being a Lagrangian barriers. So there are many examples, but it is again important for me to emphasize kind of the other end, the other end of this story. And this is a statement by McDuff and Polterovich that if you take CPN and you remove a complex submanifold, then the Gromov width is not going to change. Okay, so in some sense, this is an analog of the statement before, not precisely, but at least in some sense. Okay. Any questions up to this point? So we have this concept of Lagrangian barriers, and I should say that Lagrangian submanifolds, other than the two rigidity phenomena that I just mentioned, they appear very naturally in many other settings. Integrable systems, for example, many examples, say the Arnold-Yuville theorem, minimal surfaces, and so on and so forth. And as I said before, kind of from the symplectic topology point of view, it's kind of clear that they are the main, they play a crucial role in the story of symplectic topology. And here is a nice quote that I found in a survey paper by Abbondandolo and Schlenk. But this quote is in some sense quite typical. I mean, it's not unique. It states that Lagrangian submanifolds are the most interesting submanifolds for several reasons, and they explain why. But then they say that these are the submanifolds that exhibit symplectic rigidity. And I want to focus on this particular point. And of course, there is another well-known credo or motto by Alan Weinstein that everything is a Lagrangian submanifold. And essentially, my talk today is, in some sense, is about this line here. Okay, so what I would like to do is to try to convince you that this is not completely precise, that symplectic submanifolds can also exhibit symplectic rigidity and not just Lagrangian submanifolds.
You should say wrong, not.
Okay, so that's what I'm going to try to do next. Okay, any questions? Everything is okay up to this point? Okay. Okay, so now let's move to what we call symplectic barriers. And I can immediately just describe the main result. So as I said before, this is a joint work with Pazit Haim-Kislev and with Richard Hind. And the statement is the following. So for every arbitrary small delta, I'm not using epsilon, I'm keeping epsilon for my next slide, but for some arbitrary small delta, there exists a finite union of codimensional two disjoint symplectic hyperplanes. But if you wish, you can just think about the example of the four-dimensional ball and then just the finite union of symplectic planes, such that the complement of this finite union inside the ball has Gromov of width at most delta. So arbitrary small Gromov of width. So again, let me maybe try to make a little drawing. So this is the ball. And one can show that it is enough to remove a certain configuration of symplectic planes, such that in the complement, you can embed, I mean, that's only a very small ball. In other words, what we are trying to say here is that Lagrangians are not the only source of symplectic rigidity. This is another example, or this is an example of symplectic rigidity, which comes from symplectic submanifolds or symplectic planes. So what I will try to do next, I will try to explain the proof of this theorem, but let me ask, are there any questions? Okay. Okay, so maybe.
Uh-huh. So maybe just technical one. So the ball here is the unit ball in R to N with the standard structures.
Indeed, yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, so maybe before the proof, I want to make some remarks about this theorem. The first one is that this is not true for holomorphic planes. So for every union of let's say union sigma tilde of J holomorphic planes, the Gromov width of the complement is not going to change.
Is J here the standard J or every J?
The standard one.
Mm-hmm. So it could be that these sigmas are J holomorphic for some other J. I mean, probably. Or no.
I will have to think about it some more. I never thought about this, but I can't answer this question on the spot.
Sorry, Yaron, I might have missed something. Mm-hmm. Do you say that in the disk of dimension 2, you have a certain number of points? And that's sorry, what you're saying?
No, sorry. This is really it's a symplectic statement. It's not. It's not. Thank you, Octave. I should say that n here is at least two. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I feel
no,
much
no,
better.
No. That's a very good remark. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. No. It's a purely symplectic statement. It's definitely wrong in dimension two.
Okay, great.
Thank you. Okay, but the first remark is that you cannot play this game with complex planes. It's important that you're taking symplectic planes. And the second remark is that, well, I will discuss the proof, and in the proof, somehow the existence of this family of symplectic hyperplanes is not really explicit. But actually, and I will try to explain this point, that there exists, in a sense, an explicit construction. Of this family of hyperplanes. I will try to explain exactly how to do that. And my last remark before the proof is that we actually don't know what happens when we remove only one plane. And this is, okay, maybe I will go, okay, let me just write it down. So this is a question that appeared before in a paper by Sacco, Song, and Zab. And in that paper, they asked specifically what can be said about the Gromov width, let's say in dimension 4, of the complement of one plane. So this is in, say, Gromov, the Grassmannian 4-2. And the methods that, that we are using is somehow we cannot use the same methods to answer this particular question. So we don't know the answer when one removes a single plane from the four-dimensional ball. So I should say that, again, if V is complex, then the Gromov of width is still one. It's not going to change. When V is Lagrangian, then it follows from this example by Biron that we saw before of CPN, that the Gromov of width is going to be 1/2. But it is somehow unclear what happens when one removes the two-dimensional plane, general two-dimensional. Any questions before we move to the proof of the theorem?
So when you say not clear, I mean, you give a very specific boundary. Do we just not know anything, or do we?
So we know something, and if I will have time at the end of the talk, I will try to say what we know. But we don't have a complete answer to this question. Okay. So what I would like to do next is to explain the proof of the theorem above. So let me sketch the proof. Okay, so I need some terminology. So first I'm going to consider the kind of a standard collection of hyperplanes, standard grid. So this is why I saved the letter epsilon. So this is, I'm going to sketch the proof in dimension 4, and I'm denoting the following sigma epsilon to be the standard grid. So let's say that Z2 is in epsilon Z square. Okay, I'm just taking the standard grid of planes in C2. Okay. And I need maybe a little bit more notations. I'm going to denote by AL the linear transformation that sends Z1 to Z1. So Z1 is invariant, and Z2 to L times Z2. And okay, so this is the notation that I need. And the proof has two steps. The main one is this. We claim that for every nice domain in C2, so I'm going to assume here that D is convex. And for every parameter L, which is bigger than 1, and for every epsilon bigger than 0, so epsilon is kind of how delegates the grid is, right? There exists a symplectic embedding from the complement of a small neighborhood. So here N is just a small neighborhood of these collections of planes inside, well, some constant beta, and then AL times D. Beta is a constant that depends on everything, on the domain, on L, on epsilon. But what is important for us is that it goes to one where the grid becomes more and more fine. Okay, when epsilon goes to zero, this constant goes to one. Okay, I plan to explain the proof of this step, but let me first give you the large picture how to complete the proof. Okay. So this is the first step. And the second step I'm not sure about the reference here. In the book by Hopper and Sender, they refer, they give credit to Eliasberg, to some old paper by Eliasberg. So I thought whether I should call this Eliasberg's lemma or not, but I couldn't find a precise reference. But I think that this should go back to Eliasberg. But the observation is that for every L bigger than one, one can find a linear symplectic transformation such that the capacity of ALSB, so note that now SB, so this is like B is the unit ball, SB is going to be the domain D above. And right, so this is just an ellipsoid, right? So it doesn't really mean which capacity we use, but the important fact is that this could be arbitrarily small. And it's crucial here that L, of course, is not one, right? Now, when
this epsilon would be the delta from the statement of the theorem?
Yes, thank you. I'm using epsilon too much. Thank you. Yes. Well, it's, yeah, it's delta. Or, okay. And the when you combine these two things together, the theorem follows, so the theorem follows for the symplectic image of this very specific collection of hyperplanes. So let me maybe stop for a second and remind you what we're trying to prove. Right. So we are trying to prove that if we remove from the ball certain collection of symplectic planes, then we can make the grove of wheat arbitrarily small. So the first step tells you that for every convex domain, doesn't matter which one you take, you can remove a small neighborhood of the standard grid in C2, the standard one, the complex one. And after removing this small neighborhood, you can embed the complement inside some constant beta and then AL times B. And the second part tells you that this AL times B can be, I mean, you can choose, sorry, it's not for every D. I mean, you can choose an image of the ball, a symplectic ellipsoid, such that AL times this particular D is arbitrarily small. So the first step was true for every convex domain, but I'm actually using it only for this particular symplectic ellipsoid. Now, if you put everything together, you just need to take the original grid here, the one here, and rotate this grid by the inverse of the linear map S from the second part, the second step of the proof.
So like this would be a straight grid in the image after we apply S.
Yes, exactly. The collection of symplectic planes that appears in the theorem is just a symplectic image of the standard grid in situ.
So if I think of this S as like a, okay, never mind, I'll ask you later. But can I fix L to be just two in all of this proof?
Yes, so I mean, okay. that's a good point. What is the kind of a natural question? What is the actual relation between all the parameters here, right? We have L, we have the epsilon, how fine the grid is. And, but for the question about that you asked about L, yes, we only care that it is not one. It could be two and everything is going to work. But okay, I will explain something about the proof of the first step, and hopefully it will be clear how choosing different values of L can how it affects the proof. But for the proof of the theorem, L could be just two, and it will be okay. So I would like to explain the proof of the first step, but please stop me. Are there any questions about the big picture, how the proof actually works? Okay, so let me explain this embedding in step one. So again, I want to show you how one can remove a certain neighborhood of the standard grid from a convex, let's say a convex domain in C2, such that one can construct this symplectic embedding. And to do so, I want to first approximate in a very specific way the domain D. So let me be more precise. So we have again just the standard grid, Z1, Z2, where Z2 is in epsilon Z squared. Okay. And what I would like to denote now is a certain collection, which I'm going to denote by G alpha, of essentially two-dimensional squares, such that the vertices of these squares are in, I'm going to use pi 2 for the projection to the z2 coordinate. So the vertices are in the projection to z2 of the grid, which is just these points here. I'll make a picture in a second. But this is just a collection of two-dimensional squares. A picture will appear in a second. And let me define the approximation that I'm going to use. This is the epsilon, just this joint union over all these squares of the following. So this is going to be G alpha here. And here we have the projection to the first coordinates of a point X, such that X lies in D, and the projection of the second coordinates of X lies in G alpha. Okay, so for a second, just ignore this precise formulation. Let me just show you the picture. So what I'm trying to do here is to approximate the convex domain D with a certain union of product bodies. So how should I do that? Just give me a second. Yeah, here it goes. So you can see the original domain D, and then we have this grid of planes. And these G alphas, they are here in the projection to the second coordinate. So the basic idea is to take an element in D. So this element has two components, Z1 and Z2. And now we allow Z2 to be any point inside this little square that comes from the grid. And the domain D epsilon is just a union of these products. Does this make sense? The definition of how to approximate the domain D. Okay. So again, the general idea is to take any point inside the domain. Now we have Z1 and Z2, and we are going to allow Z2, instead of being the original point, to be any other point in this little square around it. Okay, so we kind of slightly extend the domain. But what we gain from this procedure is that now, in some sense, we work with something that looks like a product, or a union of products. And this is crucial for the proof. And another point to keep in mind is that if epsilon is very small, then even in the Hausdorff sense, the new domain D epsilon is close to D. We didn't change the domain very much. Okay, so this was the first step in the proof of, sorry, this was the, yeah, I'm proving the first step of the original, the proof of the original theorem, but this is the first part of the proof of this step. And after this reduction part, instead of working with the original domain D, what we can do now is to replace D with D epsilon. And okay, now I want to remove from here a small neighborhood of this collection of planes. And I want to embed, I want to see that this could be embedded into AL D epsilon. So note that here, so this was the reduction step. Instead of working with the original domain D, we are now working with an approximation of D, which is this approximation that you see here in this picture, just this finite union of products. And the first step in the proof was what is written here with respect, but instead of the epsilon, just to have D, but well, you have to believe me that it is enough. Of course, the epsilon contains D, so there is no problem on the left-hand side, And on the right hand side, okay, one should be a little bit careful with the constants. And to construct this embedding, we are going to take advantage of the specific structure of V epsilon and construct this embedding to be essentially two-dimensional. So the symplectic embedding is not going to do anything in the first coordinates, but it's only going to change the second coordinate. And this map psi here, so this is really a two-dimensional map, is going to be a map from R2 minus a small neighborhood of this to R2 minus maybe a slightly different, I mean, the size of this neighborhood might be slightly different, but with L here. And the main point is that this map should be area preserving. So again, let me just show you a picture. Here is the map psi. So we start with, on the left-hand side here, you see the standard grid, and we remove the white squares. We remove an epsilon neighborhood of the standard grid. Right, this is the square on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, you have essentially the same picture, but now everything is multiplied by L. The size is multiplied by L. And what we want to, and also the note that we have to change the size of the grid if we want this map to be area preserving, right? So we want the green part to go to the green part, but of course now the square has size epsilon L and not just epsilon. So we just need to remove more parts from the area, from the area of the grid, from the around the grid points. But the claim is that this can be done. I mean, one can, by hands, essentially build such a an area preserving transformation. And if you think about how this map is defined, the symplectic embedding, it takes the complement of the grid to AL times the epsilon, right? This is exactly what it was, the map was supposed to do. Okay, so maybe I tried to give too many details here, but kind of the thing to keep in mind is that the idea of the proof in general is that you can first approximate the domain D, just a nice convex domain, as in some sense a union of product bodies. And then you can use this product structure to establish this symplectic embedding inside ALD, which basically stretch the domain in the Z2 component. And to finish the proof, one needs to show that now for certain domains D epsilon or D, you can make the Gromov width to be arbitrarily small. And remember that D was at the end of the day just the symplectic ellipsoid. So you can just do everything with a domain which is a symplectic ellipsoid. We don't use the fact that this construction works for an arbitrary convex domain. Okay, so I don't have much time, but I would like to say a few words about kind of the next steps and some open questions in this direction. But before that, any questions about the proof before we continue?
In the map C, the area of the white squares is going to grow by more than an L factor, right?
Yes.
To compensate on the, okay.
Exactly, precisely, yeah. Yes. The right squares on the right-hand side should be much bigger because you want to compensate for the area which you lost. Okay, so this was the idea behind the proof. And let me, I want to say a few words about some open questions. And yeah, the first one I already mentioned, we don't know, or we cannot use the same strategy to answer the question, what will happen when we remove only one single plane? And if you think about the proof, we need to have these squares that we remove. And if we don't have enough of these squares, it's not going to work. So the strategy, the global strategy behind the proof is just not going to work when you try to remove one plane. So we don't know the answer to this question. Another thing that would be nice to know is what is the, and I'm not sure how to make it a precise statement, but kind of to understand this notion, this phenomena of symplectic barriers. In terms of dynamics. Right. So we have the ball, we remove a very specific, I mean, we have an explicit construction. So we remove a specific collection of planes. We can look at the complement. Okay, maybe we to make everything work, we need to take a little neighborhood of these collection of planes. And then we can look at the dynamics on the complement and try to understand these dynamics, right? I mean, this phenomena, this upper bound of the Gromov width, maybe, hopefully, is reflected in some sense also in the dynamics. But we don't have a clear, we don't understand exactly how to explain this phenomena in terms of the dynamics. And let me add one.
Sorry, which dynamics? Which dynamics?
Right. So yeah, it's not a well-defined question. But for example, what you can do, you can take the ball, remove a small neighborhood of this collection of planes. So trust me that there is like a specific one that you can take. And then you have a Liouville domain, right? I mean, you can try to study the symplectic dynamics on the boundary, or in some sense, the boundary of this domain. and see if you can see this upper bound on the Gromov of weight in terms of dynamics. Another question is, well, one can compactify everything, and instead of thinking about the ball, you can just move to CP2, and everything just goes to the singular point at infinity. And the complement is very small because this is what the theorem tells you, but we don't really understand. We don't have a precise description of this phenomenon in terms of dynamics. And let me add one last question, which I like. So now you can try to ask quantitative questions. So you can define, for example, a certain function of, oops, so this n is not, it's not the neighborhood from before. So it's like a certain function of epsilon. To be how many planes you need to remove to see that the complement is less than epsilon. I mean, we don't know, of course, the answer when we remove only one plane, right? But we can still use the theorem that we proved to see how to, or to try to study the number of planes in terms of how small the capacity we want to be. So I think it might be interesting to try to say something about this function. So roughly, the question is how many symplectic planes you need to start to remove from the ball to lower the size of the Gromov root, to understand exactly the relation between these two quantities. Okay, but I think my time is almost up. So let me stop at this point. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yaron. Any questions?
You make this sigma, the set you take out, connected. I mean, you can, of course, kind of introduce transversal planes and then make complex surgery. But then at the surgery, you take something out and maybe rigidity breaks down. Well, I didn't think much. It would be nice to say, okay, we can also take, of course, your set is very nice because it's so easy. I mean, just planes, but can one make it connected?
So I somehow believe that the answer should be yes, that you can kind of connect all these planes by kind of a very small neighborhood and make everything connected. At least, yeah. I mean, I don't know for sure, but I would not be extremely surprised if this would be possible.
I didn't answer the question. So if you add something, you decrease even more the Gromov width of the complement, right? So you can actually, Felix, you are muted.
Right, but then you do the surgery and then the set becomes partly a bit smaller and then I'm afraid there. But maybe the smoothening, yeah.
I see.
Yeah. Should be yes, but not just wonder whether it can be done easily or not. Mm-hmm. Would be awkward.
Yaron, could you please show again this map Psi? You had, I mean, with these beautiful squares. So,
yes.
I mean, your map is from R2 minus this to R2 minus this, but originally there was some kind of bounded domain, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So when you restrict to a bounded, I mean, so you will apply this map to what? To projection of your body D or something like this, right?
I'm taking this map. This is the symplectic embedding. I'm not doing anything on the first.
You're applying it to G epsilon minus N of sigma epsilon.
Indeed.
Uh-huh. And where it maps, so it maps to R2 minus this times C.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so my question is the following. So how this map acts on fundamental group? So you have kind of pretty big fundamental group, right? So
Yeah, I'm actually not sure. So I just want to make sure I understand the question. You want to somehow to understand the distortion?
So probably in simple terms. So if I take a loop which goes around this little white square on the left.
Right.
What happens with this loop on the right, kind of? So
right.
Isn't it going to be identity on the, like, it's the same?
Yeah, but I mean, you don't have a probably groups are different because I mean, look at this picture within a ball. So here you have more punctures on the left than on the right. I think seemingly, if I understand correctly, kind of.
I mean, if you consider the map restricted to D epsilon and then goes to AL times D epsilon, then you have the same number of squares here and there, no? So you should have the same number of holes as well, I think.
You have to change the size, right? Because the mm-hmm. make sure that this is area preserving.
Okay, so it was simply curiosity. I even don't know what I want to ask next, but indeed it seems to be a remarkable map, and yeah, one want to get acquainted with it closer. Mm-hmm.
And then there was the second step where you say comes from the Offerdender book. Is it what you said?
No. The second step, So I'm using here, essentially, it's a lemma, sometimes in linear algebra. And I think that in the book by Hofer and Sander, they refer to this lemma as Eliasberg. I mean, they give credit to an old paper by Eliasberg. But I tried to find this paper and I couldn't find the precise
statement. I think it's from functional analysis. So it's some paper where he invented some capacity with this combinatorial approach and then used it to prove the, I think, Eliasberg-Gromov theorem, something like this.
Okay.
So yeah, it's probably translated somewhere in English.
Okay, but definitely in the book by Hofer and Sander, they mm-hmm. mentioned that.
That's what Yasha did. Functional analysis and its applications in the 80s.
Nice.
And
yes, and in this step two, it doesn't really matter which capacity you use because it's convex anyway, right?
Well, it's even more than that. These are just ellipsoids, right? I mean, it's, right. Yeah.
But the original, like the theorem statement is it specific for Gromov capacity or not necessarily?
Well, right. So thank you for this question. So if you look at the steps, then I actually didn't really use the fact that this is the Grom of wheat. I mean, everything that is written here actually works for every capacity. But what is special about the Grom of wheat is that kind of the step number three, which is not, which I somehow didn't mention here, is you need to get rid of this neighborhood, right? I mean, you want to say that the ball minus the collection of planes has a small Grom of wheat, it has small capacity. And to get rid of the neighborhood, this is something that immediately holds for the Grom of wheat capacity, but a priori, maybe not for the other symplectic capacities. But the statement for the complement of a small neighborhood of the grid works for every capacity.
Cool. Thanks.
I have a question, but it's long and vague, so maybe I'll keep it for the discussion. Any more questions? If not, then let's thank Yaron again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the beautiful talk.